2018. Is there a motion?
Move approval.
Second.
We have a motion and a second. Is there any discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Opposed? The ayes have it. Now, do we want to do, let's do the Department of, let's do the Strategic Trails Plan first and then culminate everything with the wonderful festival lights.
Good morning, Madam Chair, members of the Planning Board. My name is Darren Conforti, Acting Director for the Department of Parks and Recreation. We have before you today a resolution for your endorsement of the Strategic Trails Master Plan. Staff did a detailed presentation of this plan to the Planning Board back in July. So today we're available to answer any questions you may have regarding the plan. But at this time, what we're doing is we're following up with the requirements of the planning process in order to have the plan endorsed and so that we can begin to work on it. So I have staff available to answer any questions if you have any questions. However, we didn't prepare a detailed presentation, seeing we gave one in July.
All right, are there any questions? We have a lot in our backup on this already. We have the PowerPoint. So is there a motion?
I move approval. Your second.
We have a motion and a second. Is there any discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? The ayes have it. So, okay, so item three, is it D?
C.
Festival of Light, Winter Festival of Lights. One of my favorite things in the world. Favorite events.
And we have festive weather to kick off the Festival of Lights. And so I am going to ask our festive Deputy Director of Area Operations to...
Talking about our festive director, doesn't she look so festive yet?
We're going to get her festive, don't worry.
And plus, our festive director has a lot to celebrate this month. We
yes,
have
she does indeed.
Coming up. It's really wonderful. We just had a wonderful Veterans Day celebration honoring all of our veterans, and not only in the county, but also within the agency. And let me see, what else do we have coming up?
I can't imagine what you could be talking
about.
So,
excuse me. Red Fox used to look up and say, it's the big one. It's the big one. It's the big one coming up. You know you're exposed. You know you have to be embarrassed. Two of us up here have been there, done that. You want to come on, step up to the plate? Soon to be birthday girl?
Good morning, Chair Hewlett and Commissioners, Debbie Tyner, Deputy Director for the record. Soon to be...
it's okay. You have to practice getting it out. It's okay.
Say it.
Are we streamed?
Oh, well, I don't know if we start streaming yet.
Soon to be, I like that, Darren.
That's
soon to be the Redskins Eastern Division champs.
Thank you for that. And, okay, soon to reach a significant milestone. How about that?
A winning
thank
percentage
you.
Of 60 or better.
Oh, thank you, Darren. You just let the cat out of the bag.
I just came from Wall Street, and I talked all about that certain category, which is near and dear to my heart, 60 and better.
Well, we'll
category.
See how much better it will be.
Hey.
But today,
place.
We're here to talk about a wonderful holiday festive attraction that happens to be at one of our signature parks, Watkins Regional Park. And it's the Festival of Lights that happens every year and brings out lots of people from within and outside of our county to see a wonderful light display put on by our spectacular staff. I am going to introduce to you a few of those members who are here to present what we do for the Festival of Lights and more significantly, what we've done differently this year that makes it so spectacular. So with that, I'm going to introduce, we have Peggy Schaefer, who is our program superintendent, who's here to help Leslie. And we have George Moxley, who is our park coordinator today to help out. And he's also responsible for those crews who helped to set up all of those lights. But we also have another special person in the room too, Betty. And that's Leslie Long, who is our area specialist who's going to be doing something special this year, and that's
yes.
retiring.
Yes. We have her too.
That's retiring, yes. And she wants the planning board to know that she's created something to leave you all by, and she's going to lead you all in a nice little send-off to her with her own rendition of Festival of Lights, and I'll let her get you all involved in that. So with that, I'm going to bring Leslie up, because we are going to miss her dearly. The creativity that she's brought to Watkins Park in the central area, and she comes up sparkling in her pen here and her antler ears. But we do want to celebrate Leslie as well, because you know, it's been a long time, and we go back lots and lots of years. So it's very near and dear to my heart that we're going to be losing her, but to a good thing, and that's retirement. So Leslie, please talk about Festival of Lights.
Okay, thanks, Debbie. Good morning, everyone. Yes, my name is Leslie Long, and I am the area specialist in Central Area. And as Debbie already introduced, Peggy Schaefer and George Moxley, who are with me today. But so I want to talk about, as everybody says, our favorite event, the Festival of Lights. And it will be beginning very shortly on November the 23rd and goes all the way through January 1st. But to get started, we have a little video here just to show you how we are marketing the event, or one of the ways that we're marketing the event. So, Peggy.
It was the holiday season, and there was no doubt our family was bored. We had to get out to the Festival of Lights, which starts after dark, 5 to 9:30 at Watkins Regional Park. 1 million LED lights with eye-catching flare become beautiful creations with environmental care. Snowmen and reindeer $10 a car. Santa and elves in the park's not that far. Let your holiday spirit soar to the lights. Take a cue from our family. Come to the Festival of Lights.
For more information, visit pgparks.com.
So as I'm sure you're aware, the program itself is about 6 weeks, but it takes us a lot longer to get ready than that. In fact, George Moxley's staff starts setting up in mid-September, and actually as of about this week, we think we've had about over 1,600 man hours have been put into this year's display. But first, I want to give you a little bit of background about last year. We really had a great year. We had over 20,000 cars that came through the Festival of Lights last year. And we also, every single light that we have has been converted to LED lights. So that's over 2.5 million lights. We also have a 54-foot musical Christmas tree. And it has 300,000 LED lights in it. But it also has 90 new red, blue, green lights that actually can write out messages to our visitors. So we can say like Happy Holidays or Welcome to the Festival of Lights. So if you haven't seen it, it's pretty spectacular.
Or Andre, you're the best.
Exactly. last year we collected over $200,000, which was an increase of over $90,000 from previous years. We also collected $5,000 in donations and 384 boxes of canned goods that were donated to the needy in the county. So, but this year we have a few changes. So, first of all, we're really excited that we have a new booth. It's called a Guardian booth, which is there on the right in the PowerPoint. And it actually provides heat. For those of you who've ever been to the Festival of Lights, the staff stands outside in all weather and collects the money. And it's freezing, usually. So now we're going to be actually having a secure area for the staff to be in. And the biggest change is that we are no longer going to be cash only. We will still accept cash, but we're also going to collect Visa. You can pay with any major credit card, and you can also purchase your tickets online. So we're very excited about that. Also new, we have festival spectacles. And actually, if we have a couple of, we have a little gift bag here. So everybody, you should have your, pull out your spectacles. And basically what, and George is going to be our little model. He's going to walk up. If you look at his little blinky light.
Turn. So I'm the model.
Yes. The glass, they provide like a hologram type image of a snowflake. And so you can kind of see it. Can you see it?
Yeah, well, I think you might have to be a little closer. Or could be that 60 and better thing.
Yeah, have to be a little
closer. Oh, yeah. Okay.
So we're going to be selling those this year.
Oh, you're welcome.
Okay.
Yeah, so we're selling those this year to the patrons for $1. So it kind of gives a new little sparkle to the Festival of Lights. We also have, we're also doing a, in our program, we're doing a little I Spy program, which you can see a little copy of the map up there, where kids can, when they're riding in the back seat, they can check off what they've seen.
Oh, that's so
that's
cool.
Good.
Yeah, and then also for the Turkey Trot, which is coming up very quickly, that'll be Saturday. And these are going to be coloring pages that will be available for the kids to color as well. So we're pretty excited about all of that. So you can see that we have some really great things going on. So if you really want to see the lights yourself, we are recommending that you come to our grand opening, which is going to be on Monday, November the 19th. And in your packet is your parking pass. And so you'll be all set, okay?
Thank you.
But also in your package, there's a little bit of something that you have to pull out. And everybody here should get one of these because we're really going to get into the festival season. I had to take a little bit of an idea from Kathy Garrity, who has retired. So I can't write poems, but I did rewrite the words.
Okay.
To Jingle Bells, and we're all going to sing along
right now.
So we're sorry. I know it's before. It is before Thanksgiving. I'm sorry, but the tune is to Jingle Bells.
Wait, hold up.
Yeah.
No love. No love. No love.
No love.
Commissioner Dorner had to get.
So we need everybody.
Okay. We expect everybody to join in. This is a sing along. And if you have your, there are some bells in there too, so if you want to ring your bells, because it is to Jingle Bells.
Right here.
And you can follow along. If you don't have the song, the words, you can follow along. On the 19th at 6 o'clock. Okay, so is everybody ready? I'm so happy my voice is going to be on this microphone. So. Okay, are you ready? Dashing through the park in a four-door SUV. Enjoying 2 million lights and a 54-foot tree. Now we can pay online or use a credit card to see the holiday lights all in our backyard. FOL for just a $10 fee. Or have some fun as you run in the trot for Turkey. Oh, FOL. Thanks to all the staff who spend so much time to make it great on your behalf.
Woo-hoo! Thank you. That is so awesome. Does that conclude the presentation? Okay. So let me just say this. I was going to announce this shortly, but our Festival of Lights does commence on the Friday after Thanksgiving. It is amazing. We've had a little brief presentation and gotten you in the spirit already, but we're being streamed. And I want all our Prince George's County residents who happen to watch this and those who are visitors and need everyone to spread the word, because it's an amazing treat. And all of us have stress in our lives. We have stress at work, we have stress at home sometimes, we have stress definitely during the holidays, and it's a wonderful excursion to go through and indulge your inner child and see the lights that people work so hard for. Even at Kinderfest, you can see all of the exhibits going up. So I want to remind everyone to come. We want to thank Leslie so much for her efforts and her creativity, which brings me to this wonderful resolution of appreciation that we have for Leslie Long, and that whereas Leslie has ably and conscientiously served the citizens of Prince George's County for 29 years as a key member and leader of the Prince George's County Department of Parks and Recreation, and whereas in recognition of her array of exemplary professional skills and abilities, Leslie also served in a variety of progressively responsible positions, including assistant manager at College Park Airport and Wells Lincoln Complex, event coordinator and acting assistant general manager for Showplace Arena, facility manager for the Prince George's Ballroom and Snow Hill Manor, and regional manager for Southern Area Operations. And then we have more, but she does have a farewell, so I'll save some for that. Now, therefore, be it resolved that the Prince George's County Planning Board of the Maryland National Capital Park and Planning Commission commends Leslie Long on her retirement, thanks Leslie for her outstanding service and dedication to the commission, and wishes her the very best of health, happiness, and good fortune in the years to come. Don't applaud yet, because actually this doesn't count until we get a vote. Is there a motion?
So move.
Second.
We have a motion and a second to approve this resolution that I just read. Is there any discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? It's unanimous. Leslie, we congratulate you and wish you the very best in retirement. Come back. The retirees get to come to all of our employee appreciation events and to Festival of Lights. And so please come. We want to thank everybody who worked so hard on putting this event on. So thank you so very much. Also, we're going to close out with, again, everybody has to say, happy birthday to Debbie.
Happy birthday, Debbie.
It's a great place to be.
It's a great place to be.
I have other announcements. So I know that concludes Parks and Rec for today, but Ms. Cardell Jones, who is the mother of Sharon Bowman, who is a child care specialist with the Department of Parks and Recreation Special Programs Division, we want to remember her. We want to remember Sharon and her family in our thoughts and prayers. We want to remember the victims of the California wildfires. The total keeps escalating, as I think the last I heard was 50 people killed and more than 237 acres scorched. I do want to mention Stan Lee, who was just one of my heroes, period. You know, he had his heroes, he was mine. He was a legendary writer, editor, and publisher who rose through the ranks of Marvel Comics, the creator or co-creator of Black Panther, Spider-Man, the X-Men, the Mighty Thor, Iron Man, the Fantastic Four, the Incredible Hulk, Doctor Strange, and so many more. He was the native New Yorker and I would say the king of cameos, but I'll call him the prince of cameos after Alfred Hitchcock. And he was married for 70 years to his beloved wife who died last year, so sometimes that happens. So we want to remember him. And also we want to remember Wally Triplett, who at age 92 passed away. He was the former Detroit Lions running back and the first African-American player drafted in the NFL. So, and for anyone else who may have suffered a loss that of which I am unaware, we reach out to you and you're in our thoughts and prayers. May I have a moment of silence, please? Thank you. And speaking of Stan Lee, I wanted to highlight, are Parks and Rec people still here? So we have our Imagination Playground book. We have 26 of these phenomenal Imagination Playground, including the award-winning Wonderful Wizard of Oz Park at Watkins Park, Playground at Watkins Park, which just won the coolest playground in the United States by Mommy Nearest. I said nearest, not dearest. And was featured in the International Landscaping magazine and received an award for that. So that's one of our 26. But in light of Stan Lee's passing, I want to make sure that everyone is directed to the comic-themed playground where you will find Captain America and many other superheroes. So I just wanted to point that out. So if anyone has kids who want to bring them to our Imagination Playgrounds, I welcome them to that. I do want to say we are in November. It is, first of all, it is Epilepsy Awareness Month, Lung Cancer Awareness Month, American Diabetes Awareness Month, and Pancreatic Cancer Awareness Month. It is Long-Term Care Awareness Month. It is Healthcare and Hospice Awareness Month. It is the month where we National Family Caregivers Month. It is American Indian Heritage Month, where we celebrate and honor all the various American Indian backgrounds that we have all over the nation, but particularly right here in Prince George's County. And I invite everyone to go see our American Indian Village right on the Patuxent, which is phenomenal. It is National Adoption Month, and I'm looking around the room. Okay, some people are in compliance. It is No Shave November or Movember, which raises awareness for men's health issues. So, some people are either being really conscientious or they're just a little lazy. Okay. I do want to say also, it is National Hunger and Homeless Awareness Week, National Split Pea Soup Week, because we're foodies up here. We have to discuss those things. It is also it's Military Family Appreciation Month. And we want to recognize the families, because as we honor veterans, those who have served, those who have passed on, those who continue to serve, those in our agency, we want to remember the families of the veterans, because they sacrifice tremendously as well. They do without their parents, their siblings, their children, their son, you know, for indefinite periods of time, worry endlessly, will their loved one return? So we want to remember them as well. On November the 15th, 1777, after 16 months of the debate, the Continental Congress approved the Articles of Confederation, which was the agreed upon constitution of the 13 original states. November 15th, where's our DPR folks? November 15th is America Recycles Day. We take recycling very seriously. We're doing the 1 million more challenge, so step it up. This is National Philanthropy Day. And for those who may be interested, it is National Clean Out Your Fridge Day. On this day, 11/15/1969, an estimated 2 million people took part in the Vietnam War moratorium demonstration all across the United States. And then finally, in the food department, because that's how we close out, it is Banana Pudding Lovers Month, National Pomegranate Month, World Vegan Month, and my personal favorite, National Peanut Butter Lovers Month. And without further ado, we will acknowledge the birthdays. Langley Wiggins. Langley is never visible, but Langley, can you get Langley to come in? I want everyone to see Langley. He makes sure that all of this works, all of our communications, the microphones, is Langley. So you thought we forgot your birthday. We did not forget your birthday. Happy birthday, Langley. Happy birthday. Mr. Cosby, happy birthday, Mr. Cosby. Michael. And again, happy birthday, Debbie. And without further ado, I may have missed some others, so I apologize if I have. And without further ado, we're going to resume with our agenda. Did I miss any other birthdays nobody told me about? We have the consent agenda here. Is there anyone here to speak on items 4A through 4D, or any board member who wishes to discuss any of these items? Is there a motion?
Madam Chair, I move approval after consideration of the record for items 4A, 4B, 4C, and 4D. I move adoption of the staff findings and approval of the items on the consent agenda in accordance with the recommendation of the staff.
Second.
We have a motion and a second. Is there any discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? The ayes have it. We're proceeding in this order. Item 6, followed by 5, followed by 7 and 8, which are companion cases. Okay. Mr. Bishop?
Good morning, Madam Chair, members of the board. For the record, Andrew Bishop with the Urban Design Section. In a memorandum dated October 22nd, 2018, the applicant's representative, Arthur Horn, requested a continuance of DSP 14008-03 for the Crescent at Largo from November 15th to November 29th, 2018, to allow the applicant additional time to address outstanding issues. The urban design section recommends approval of this request.
Okay. Thank you, Mr. Bishop. Now, Mr. Horn?
Yes, good morning, Madam Chairman, members of the Planning Board. For the record, Arthur Horn, Law Office of Shipley and Horn in Largo, Maryland. Yes, ma'am. This is an application just adding a use to the table of uses in the Largo Sector Plan, which requires a DSP. We're working out some last-minute issues, but we'll be ready for November the 29th.
Okay, thank you. Are there any questions of Mr. Horn? Ms. Jones, the issue for us that day, we have, that's a really tight agenda. Is this something you expect to take a long time? I mean, do we have a tight agenda that day?
I'm sorry, what's the day?
The 29th, as I was saying.
I'm not
there either. Are you not there? Okay. Okay, but I'm talking about, you know, the big case we have.
That's from the 29th.
I'm just trying to figure out how we look time-wise for that day, because I know that's going to be very long.
Yeah.
And I don't know how many other cases.
There's only four other besides that one.
Okay, and the other are non-controversial, I think. That's what I'm asking. I'm just making sure you all are ready before we agree to this date.
Two additional cases.
So four plus two more?
No, I'm saying two cases may be controversial.
Okay.
Madam Chair,
yes.
If I may, we don't anticipate any issues with that application.
And then we have a reconsideration. And by the way, I know we have some reconsiderations that are dated coming up, so we'll have to make sure we have at least four members. Okay. All right. So, you know, it's just going to be a very, very, very long day. You might have some control over that.
I'm just fine. Yes, ma'am.
Okay. So, was there a motion? Was there anyone else here to speak on this? Is there a motion?
Madam Chair, I move that we, on item number 6, DSP 14008-03, grant a continuance to November 29th, 2018.
Second.
We have a motion and a second. Is there any discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Opposed? The ayes have it. Item 5.
Good morning, Madam Chair, members of the board. For the record, I'm Joseph Bonaducci with the Subdivision and Zoning Section, presenting item number 5 before you today, preliminary plan of subdivision 4-18005 for Cambridge Place at Westphalia. The subject site is proposing one parcel for the development of a 349,860 square foot industrial building. The site is located in the central area of Prince George's County within planning area 78 and Council District 6. More specifically, this site is located on the south side of Westphalia Road, approximately 1/2 mile east of its intersection with Maryland 4, also known as Pennsylvania Avenue. The subject site is located in the mixed-use transportation zone. Council Bill 49-2018 permits industrial development on this site until July 2019. The property is bounded to the north by Westphalia Road with single-family dwellings and a neighborhood school and park site owned by M-NCPPC in the rural residential zone and two family dwellings in the multifamily medium density residential zone beyond. The site is bounded to the northeast by vacant land planned for development of multifamily dwellings. This is phase one of the Cambridge Place at Westphalia project under preliminary plan of subdivision 4-11012 in the MXT zone. To the east, the site is bounded by land that is under construction for the development of single family attached and detached dwellings as part of the parkside development located in the residential medium zone. And vacant land abuts the property to the south, and industrial uses abut the property to the west, all within the light industrial I-1 zone. The site is located within the military industrial overlay zone, military installation overlay zone. The maximum height for structures in this area is 150 feet above the runway surface. New structures will be required to comply with the height restriction, which will be further examined at the time of detailed site plan review. The aerial photograph shows the site is currently developed with a 142,500 square foot building, which is proposed to be raised. The site map shows topographical features on the subject site with steep slopes present on the southwest portion of the site. The master plan right-of-way map shows Westphalia Road, a collector highlighted in green, which abuts the subject site at its northern edge, and MC 634, a major collector, which is unbuilt and runs north and south, north to south through the property highlighted in blue. The applicant is proposing to dedicate the full 100-foot right-of-way width with this plan. The critical intersections identified in this slide and as further detailed in the staff report were analyzed and will continue to operate at adequate levels of service given the total development proposed in this application and conditions of approval. Therefore, adequate transportation facilities will exist to serve the site. The preliminary plan shows the subject property outlined in red. It's proposed to be subdivided into one parcel and two outparcels for industrial development. The area associated with the previously approved CSP and preliminary plan are outlined in blue. The Planning Board heard and approved Preliminary Plan 4-11012 on June 5th, 2014, which subdivided the property into two parcels for the development of 301 multifamily units, that's parcel one and phase one, and 142,500 square feet of existing industrial development, which was parcel two, phase two. And this preliminary plan is for the redevelopment of parcel two, and if approved, will supersede the previous prelim for parcel two, phase two of the Cambridge of Westphalia site. Adequate public facilities will, adequate public facilities including water, sewer, fire, rescue, and police facilities are available to serve the subject site. The site contains woodlands, which will be preserved and are highlighted here in green. The applicant is proposing one impact with this application for stormwater outfall to be placed within the PMA and stream buffer, and this impact is circled in red. The applicant submitted this exhibit showing the PMA impact area in more detail. A pedestrian and bikeway facilities plan was approved with the previous preliminary plan, and this document reflects the conditions of the CSP and the proposed connection into the Parkside Smith Home Farm development. As part of the approval of the subject application, this exhibit should be updated to reflect the changes made as part of the current plan. Staff recommends that the Planning Board adopt the findings and approve Preliminary Plan of Subdivision 4-18005 TCP1 -011-12-02, subject to the 10 conditions contained in the staff report. And this concludes staff's presentation.
Okay, are there any questions of Mr. Onyebuchi? Thank you. Mr. Horn.
Thank you, Madam Chairman, members of the board. For the record, Arthur Horn, the law office of the Shipley Horn in Largo, Maryland, here on behalf of the applicant Cambridge Place as Westphalia LLC, represented by its owners, Mr. Dan Gordon, Mr. Stephen Massioli. I have with me also here today for transportation, Mr. Mike Linhart, and our civil engineer from Boulder is Mr. Nick Speed. Madam Chairman, as I will do on November the 29th, I'll say here today, this is very brief. And we agree with staff recommendations and all the conditions. I have no changes, no edits. No amendments. We want to certainly thank Mr. Onyebuchi and all the other staff members who have worked on this so desperately and so diligently.
Yeah.
And many of you all may know this is where the old Pepco building is located off of Westphalia Road. And as was mentioned, we're in the military industrial overlay area, so houses won't go there. We're right in the fight path, and the industrial use, as the county council has recognized by putting a legislation to allow us to proceed with the industrial use, is what we're going to proceed here and do. So I'm here to answer any questions you might have, but we appreciate all the hard work of the staff and agree with the recommendations and conditions.
Are there questions of Mr. Horn at this time? Let me just confirm, you have a number of people on the sign-up list. It doesn't appear that any of them wish to speak. It appears that all who have signed up are in agreement. I just want to double-check. Daniel Gordon, Matthew Jones, Nicholas Speech, and Stephen Masiola, you're all here in agreement, right? Okay, and then no one wished to speak, right? Was there anyone who did wish to speak whose name I did not call? Okay. Anything else to add?
No, ma'am.
Okay, is there a motion?
Yeah, Madam Chair, after consideration of the staff report and 4-180005, and the findings, about the findings and the conclusions and conditions, I move that we adopt 4-180005 along with TCP 1-011-12-002.
Second.
We have a motion and a second. Is there any discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? The ayes have it. Mr. Horn, you weren't by any chance hinting that you'd like to be called early on the 29th, were you?
No, ma'am. Okay. Just letting you know I'll be very brief.
Okay. All right, next on the agenda we have 7 and 8 companion cases.
Good morning, Madam Chair, members of the board. For the record, Andrew Bishop with the Urban Design Section. I am presenting items 7 and 8 and would like to incorporate the record for detailed site plan 17054 and special permit 17001, which have been filed to increase the number of residents in the existing congregate living facility from 8 to 14 residents and construct the related site improvements.
We will incorporate the record of one into the other. Thank you.
The site is located in Planning Area 68, Council District 2. The property is located on the southeast quadrant of Maryland 410 and 41st Place, specifically at 4111 East-West Highway. The property is zoned R55 and bound to the north by Maryland 410, also known as East-West Highway, south and east by single-family detached residential dwellings in the R55 zone, and west by 41st Place. The subject site and all the surrounding properties are located within the traditional residential neighborhood character area of the Development District Overlay Zone for the Gateway Arts Overlay. This aerial shows the site with the existing congregate living facility for 8 residents on the site. The site is currently developed with and is relatively flat and contains no environmental features. The property is adjacent to the master planned arterial right-of-way of Maryland 410 on the north. The bird's eye image shows the property looking south with the existing building and the existing parking lot on the site, which was constructed without a permit and is being validated with this application. The vehicular...
Can you explain that, Mr. Bishop? What was constructed without a permit?
This parking lot located here towards Maryland Route 410 was constructed without the permit.
Thank you.
The vehicular entrance to the site from Maryland 410 is being modified with this application and proposes a two-way drive aisle with a varied width travel lane tapering from 22 feet at the entrance on 410 to 8 feet to avoid an existing tree located at this location. The standard drive aisle width would normally require departure, but can be approved by the planning board if it is found in conformance with all the applicable development district standards, as further discussed on page 5 of the report. The drive aisle provides access to that existing parking compound, and it is located near the main entrance to the building. Due to the location of the existing house and the existing drive aisle, the applicant has requested alternative compliance and is proposing additional landscaping on the eastern portion of the site to buffer the adjacent residential homes. The landscaping was found to be equally effective as normal compliance for the buffer requirements. The DSP was found in conformance with the requirements of the sector plan, the zoning ordinance for the R55 zone, the landscape manual, the woodland and wildlife habitat conservation and tree canopy coverage ordinances, and the urban design section recommends the planning board adopt the findings of this report and approve detailed site plan DSP 17054, SP 17001, and AC 18010, including the departure for the drive aisle width, subject to the conditions found in this staff report. This concludes staff's presentation.
Thank you, Mr. Bishop. Are there any questions?
I have a question about, okay. So this the site plan, I don't know, can you get, on this slide, and it might be sort of them looking at different places, but to the left of the site, or to the west of it, the street right there, 41st Place?
Mm-hmm. Yes.
I don't know if that's 41st Place or Avenue, because a couple of the other slides kind of flip back and forth, and Hyattsville's terrible in its road names that flip back and forth, and sometimes we have the same road changing names, and sometimes there's a 41st Place and Avenue right next to each other. So is that 41st Place to the left, or is that 41st Avenue?
That is 41st Place.
Place, okay. And because on some of the other slides, it looks like it's actually maybe referred to as Avenue when it was going through. I couldn't really tell on some of the write-up. So if we could just check that. And in the staff report, there's mention of a sidewalk to that side on 41st Avenue and not construct, and the recommendation to not construct is a sidewalk. Is it on 41st Place that the sidewalk would have been, or where would the sidewalk have been proposed?
The sidewalk would have been proposed along 41st Place, this direction.
Okay, because the staff report was talking about it on 41st Avenue. Mm-hmm. So if we could correct that, then that would be helpful. And then can you give us a little bit of indication why the sidewalk isn't recommended around there? Because most of this area has sidewalks on both sides of the streets. And I've actually gone to the property across the street and walked on these sidewalks and stuff up to the Safeway and other places and shops up there.
For the record, Mark Lewis DeGrace, Transportation Planning Staff. When we first looked at this application, we did consider a sidewalk along 41st Place. After internal discussions and talking to the City of Hyattsville indicated that based on conversations with their Department of Public Works, they had no desire for a sidewalk along that road. And we deferred to them under certain circumstances, and after talking to them, we decided it was appropriate to leave the roads as is and not request a sidewalk on the east side there.
What's the rationale for it? Because originally our opinion was that we should have it, right?
Yes.
And so what's the rationale for not having it? Because later on that side of the street, I think there are sidewalks, although they may not be as wide as our typical
master plan. My recollection from a site visit was that there were no sidewalks on that side of 41st in the immediate vicinity.
Okay.
Talking to Hyattsville, and we kind of talked internally, and we didn't feel that there was a rational nexus for asking for a sidewalk there because there were no additional external changes to the property.
Okay. And how do the residents, I mean, I guess I can ask the applicant afterwards, but how do the residents actually walk around there? Would they take a sidewalk or not?
I defer to the applicant on that.
Okay. All right, thank you.
Are there any other questions at this time? Okay. Okay, Ms. Heather, you had to help me out again.
That's okay. Delapolsky.
Delapolsky.
Yeah, you actually think of it like D-E-L-L-A, Polsky. It's much easier phonetically than looking at the actual spelling.
Okay. Thank you.
Yes. Good morning. Heather Delapolsky, land use attorney with Linos and Blocker, here on behalf of the applicant, and I also have, on behalf of the applicant, Emmanuel and Regina Isong. They're very excited to be here. We've been in this process for quite a while, so I got an email from them at 7:30 this morning that they were here and ready to go, so, and we also, which is a smart move given the weather, and also have with us Chris Rizzi and Tony White of Bowler Engineering, and obviously Katie Gerbys from the City of Hyattsville is in the audience, and we've worked closely with the city of Hyattsville throughout the process and been before their mayor and council back over the summer as well. So with regard to the sidewalk, I think staff, you know, answered certainly the question. And there is sidewalk on the other side of the street there as well. And as staff had indicated, you know, the city had indicated that they do not actually want the sidewalk along our property frontage on 41st Place. So all were in agreement on that. We are in full agreement with all of the proposed conditions, and we don't have any questions or concerns that we need to raise today. We're just very excited to finally be here. So we're happy to answer any other questions that you may have, or certainly bring up the applicant or any of our consultants if you have questions.
Are there any questions of Ms. Delapolsky?
Very good.
I just have a quick question. So how would the residents of this house actually walk out into the street? Would they walk in the non-permitted parking lot, or would they go up the sidewalk onto the street and just sort of cross over? There's a little bit of frontage right there, but are they mobile at this point? I'm not sure.
Yeah, maybe I'll take a general stab, and if the Isongs maybe want to give any more clarification. But you know, it's an assisted living facility, so there is sort of, you know, limited mobility of the residents. There is outdoor space that they can utilize that's on the property, so they can go out in the nice weather. But in terms of the residents really, you know, walking off the property and circulating, there's very, very little of that would occur.
Okay. Do they ever go outside of the house and into the nearby area, or?
Emmanuel, Regina, would you, one of you like to come up?
You
need to go.
Yeah, if you want to, if you can
identify
that
yourself and come here.
Yeah, good morning. My name is Emmanuel Isong. So,
can you talk closely into the microphone?
So we have, the residents that we have, mostly elderly, and most of them don't have desire to really be walking. And however, we have an area in the back of the house. We all, you know, they come out, congregate, usually in the summertime, and the family come along, and we have most of the families come like every day to see them, sit down, talk to them, and we have physical therapists that try to come and help them out. A lot of them really don't want to be walking, you know, because they have bad legs, swollen, and they're not in no shape to be able to come out and walk even to the street. We used to have one veteran, we still have him, that used to walk around and come back, but right now he says he can't do it anymore because his legs are giving up on him.
Okay, so do you take them around? Like, do you ever take them in a wheelchair and kind of go around the neighborhood or anything?
If they want to, you know. Okay. We had a guy that used to want to, but he, when we go out, and he said, I want to go back, you know, so.
Okay, because I'm asking just sort of for a safety concern, because I've run and biked and pushed a stroller on East West Highway, and it's not safe. And the sidewalks are not very good. They're broken. There's trees in the way. It's not a very kind of easy area to access. So I was kind of wondering if that sidewalk in front of the house I'm looking at, if you have a ramp that would go down into the street, to if you were taking them around, that would be like ADA compliant if you take people out, and if that would be an easier way for you to kind of get into the neighborhood and get them outside if they even go outside.
Yeah.
Because I'm thinking about safety for like the people here. It's not very safe to be going up to East West Highway and exiting that way in a wheelchair if you were to take people around the neighborhood.
Well, that is correct. If we want to take them, we rather not go on the East West Highway.
Yeah.
We rather go on the other side, you know, on the neighborhood.
Yeah, and
on the East West Highway.
Is there a way for you to get down? And I'm looking at the picture right here, that sidewalk that goes in front of the house. Is there a ramp down into the street that you can take, or is it just like a cut-off?
We have a ramp from the property to the parking lot, and then we can wheel them to the street, and then we can come around, you know, into the neighborhood.
Okay.
But that's on East West Highway. But that's on East West Highway. The ramp takes them down
to the parking lot.
On what Commissioner Dorner is saying, it seems as if you come down that ramp and then you're going towards East West Highway. to wheel them around.
Mm-hmm.
And that's the concern that Commissioner Dorner has, I believe.
Yeah, because I was thinking maybe the sidewalk in front of the housing. If you don't want to make sidewalks all the way down 41st, then it might be nice if there's a cutout in the curb so you can get across, and maybe a crosswalk on 41st across it, just to make sure that there's safe, that it's okay for you guys to go through there. Because sometimes the cars, I run and walked right there.
Yes.
And sometimes the cars can come fast off of East West Highway when I've been running over there.
Okay.
And my concern would be that you probably wouldn't want to be going down to East West Highway, but if you come across the front of the house, just having some paint on the street or something to make it obvious that there's people who might be using that to get across to the sidewalk might be nice. I don't know if that curb actually that hits the house right there. So does this actually go down? Could you actually take a wheelchair down into there? Is it a cut down, or is it just flat cut off of the sidewalk? Because that would be my concern of just getting people across the street. So that way you don't have to take them down there.
Is there a cut in the curb?
Oh, yeah, there is. But as I said before, these are old people, and most of them are in their 90s.
Okay.
We recently had a 104, pass away in March, and they are in no, I mean, they don't want to go out. You know, the only place they want to go out is the come out into, we have a place in the front of the house, they park and they sit down, and they're happy to watch the cars go by and see what's going on. I mean, that's, and they're happy to do that.
Okay.
And then in the back of the house, when we have a cookout, they're happy to sit down there and have fun. They're nowhere want to go out and walk around and, in the street at all. These are very, very old people.
Okay.
And they're happy to be inside. Most of them don't want to go out.
Okay. All right.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Okay. Are there any other questions? Ms. Gervais?
Good morning. For the record, my name is Katie Gervais, planner with the City of Hyattsville. I'm here today to speak in support of DSP 17054 and its associated special permit. As talked about this morning, we have been working with the applicant for literally years on this project in order to make it happen. So we're happy that we're finally kind of seeing some progress, and we're here before you all today to make this happen. In kind of our conversations with staff as well as the applicant pertaining to the sidewalk, we decided that a sidewalk was not appropriate there because the sidewalk does not continue further down 41st Place. And we didn't want to have kind of a sidewalk to nowhere situation where folks felt like they could walk on that area and then all of a sudden they're struck with no sidewalk. That's another problem that we need to work on, is getting a sidewalk down the rest of 41st Place. But because it's a sidewalk to nowhere and the fact that there's no external changes really happening to the property here, we didn't think it was appropriate to mandate that the applicant install a sidewalk. It'd be one thing if they were already disturbing ground and kind of doing some construction on site, but really they're kind of coming retroactively to get permission to expand the number of occupants that they have. That's all I have. If you have any questions, I'm happy to take them.
I have one follow-up on what Commissioner Dorner said.
Sure.
What about a marked crosswalk on that one?
We can look into that. Yeah.
So that if anybody does, you have that safety feature.
Yeah, I can speak with our Director of Public Works and see what her thoughts on that are.
Thank you.
Mm-hmm. Are there any other questions or comments? Thank you, Ms. Gervais.
Thank you.
Ms. Delapolska, anything else to add?
Nope.
Okay.
We're in agreement with the conditions.
Thank you. Was there anyone else who wished to speak whose name I did not call? Is there a motion?
Madam Chair, on consideration of the record, the testimony, and the findings of staff and the conditions, I move that we approve DSP 17054, SP 170001, Alternative Compliance 180104 Mama's Care Assisted Living Facility, and adopt the findings of fact, conclusions of law.
Does that include the special permit also?
Yes.
Yeah.
Okay.
I'll second.
We have a motion and a second. Is there any discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? The ayes have it. Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Okay, Mr. Hunt. Is there any additional business to come
over? Madam Chair, that's all we have for you today.
Okay. Planning Board adjourned. What happened to the base of this thing?